Hello, friends. Welcome back to the James Lawrence Allcott channel. Now, we all get things wrong sometimes. Sometimes more than once. I mean, you've seen my haircuts over the last couple of years. But it's knowing when to hold your hands up and be able to admit that you were wrong that makes you a good person. So in this video, we're going to put forward a player from every Premier League club that deserves an apology. Is it too late to say sorry? Do. Let's find out. Speaking of sorry, if you are looking for redemption yourself because you haven't subscribed or hit the notification bell, now is the chance. Chuck in a like and all is forgiven. Arsenal, Granit Xhaka, crucial to Arsenal's system. Xhaka has gone from being booed off to being a cult hero within the space of a couple of years. Amazing turnaround. His goal versus Spurs, it epitomised this, and the emotion shown by himself and the team and the fans when he scored that goal, it was a very nice moment that showed that he's rescued his career at the Emirates. And this is one of the bad ones for me, that I was super wrong about him. It was not the player, it was the role. And now we know this, of course. So sorry, Xhaka. Aston Villa, John McGinn, unwanted criticism. Now, this is one where I probably, I am one of those people who has criticised him, but I'm not criticising him. He's a great player. This is a player that's been, linked with Man United. This is Man United that we're talking about. But with John McGinn, he's getting a lot of criticism right now because he's not playing brilliantly and his pass completion numbers aren't great. All of this I have said on the channel, I know that. But what I'm trying to say is it's not him. It's the system, a bit like Xhaka as well. Put him in a system that allows him to thrive and show off his strength with a bit more space, because he can fill all this space because of the stamina and quality that he has. And we will be saying, I told you so, when it comes to John McGinn, because he is a fantastic player that's playing in a team that's just playing a little bit too narrow at this moment in time. Bournemouth, Chris Meppham, who is a player that we've put forward for people to sign or for them to get rid of him a few times, and many thought that he wouldn't be good enough for the Premier League. And I'm sorry, Chris, but I think you're doing pretty well right now. Now, many thought, including some Bournemouth fans, that Chris Meppham would be found out playing in the Premier League. And at times he has struggled, but so has everyone at Bournemouth, and it will be a struggle at times. However, in his 10 matches that he's played so far, he's been able to keep clean sheets on three occasions. He's been a huge part of their defence this season, and they are still yet to lose to a side outside the top six at the time of recording. Brentford, Mathias Jensen, another one I've had a stinker here. He is filling Eriksen's boots. Now, when Christian Eriksen left in the summer, many of us were wondering where Brentford's open play, creative output would come from. Many of us had thought that Jensen wasn't really good enough to do this role. However, this season, he has been brilliant in creating for his teammates. He's averaging 2.82 shot-creating actions per 90, the most of any Brentford player that's played a decent amount of minutes this season, and is also averaging 22 touches in the final third. Third most in the Brentford squad so far this season. Jensen is becoming a really solid Premier League creator, and we owe him an apology on this channel for that, for suggesting that he is not good enough. But I don't think I'm alone in this one. I think a lot of Brentford fans thought the same after. I am delighted to say that Lightyear is the sponsor of today's video. What is Lightyear? Lightyear is an investment app that's on a mission to get Europe investing. But what makes Lightyear different to all the others? Well, one, education. Yeah, never invested before. Well, Lightyear makes it easier by giving you a wealth of data and information on the brands and funds you want to invest in, so you can be more confident in your decision making, which, as you guys know, is something I massively, massively struggle with. Number two, access, yeah? Lightyear has over 3,000 global stocks and ETFs.
An exchange-traded fund ETF is a type of pooled investment security that operates much like a mutual fund. Typically, ETFs will track a particular index sector, commodity, or other asset. But unlike mutual funds, ETFs can be purchased or sold on the stock exchange the same way that a regular stock can. An ETF can be structured to track anything from the price of an individual commodity to a large, diverse collection of securities. ETFs can even be structured to track specific investment strategies.
As I said, over 3,000 global stocks and ETFs available for its users right across Europe, giving you access to the global stock market from wherever you may be. Three! They're one of the cheapest platforms to invest your money for the long term, as they don't charge trading fees or account fees. In fact, the only fee they charge is a 0.35% currency conversion fee. And you can find more info on pricing in the link in the description. Lightyear is now available in 20 countries throughout Europe. If you are watching this from a country that spends either the pound or euro, it's available to you right now. Now, guys, I'd love to help you guys start to build your own investment portfolio. So if you sign up to Lightyear right now with James and make your first trade, I'll send you $10 fractional share of your choice. But as always, Lightyear have asked me to remind you that when you invest, your capital is at risk and the value of any investment can, of course, decrease as well as increase. Link is in the description. Off you go then. Get started building your investment portfolio today. Brighton, one of the best players in the league so far this season. Yes, that's right, Danny Welbeck. He has led the line brilliantly for Brighton this season, be that under Potter or De Zerbi. For years, we've been saying that Brighton need another striker and that their strikers don't score enough goals. However, I think it would be very hard for Brighton to replace Danny Welbeck in terms of what he offers them, in terms of his intelligent movement, link play, and energy. He might not be the most clinical of strikers, but he's come a hell of a long way from his time at Watford. Very impressed with him tactically more than anything this year. Chelsea, Thiago Silva, PSG, this one's for you. Apologise right now. Now, this one, as I said, specifically targeted towards PSG. It was deemed that Thiago Silva was finished, not good enough to play for PSG, and consequently, they didn't offer him a contract, despite the Brazilian defender going on record stating that he was happy to stay at PSG, which probably means that he would have taken revised terms. Since signing for Chelsea, he's won the Champions League. PSG, of course, have not done. He's also been a Rolls-Royce for them, generally, for the most part, and PSG need to apologise for their disrespect right now. Crystal Palace, Jeffrey Schlupp. So versatile. Now, a lot of people don't rate Jeff Schlupp, whatever you want to call him. Those people need to grow up. They need to grow up fast, okay? Because Jeff Schlupp offers so much in terms of versatility, energy, and overall quality in midfield. He covers so much ground and applies himself brilliantly. And with Cheick Doucouré now in the side, his talents aren't needed as much. I understand that. But if Doucouré isn't fit, you see the true importance of having a player like him. It's a tough one for him because he's just never truly been the starter, be it at Leicester City or Crystal Palace. But he is a very, very competent performer at Premier League level. Everton and Everton fans, this is the one you've been waiting for. I teased this a couple of weeks ago that we're going to be talking about the boy, Alex Iwobi. And stop what you're doing right now and apologise to Wobes. Nearly vomited. Sticking with Wobes? Yeah, let's stick with Wobes. Okay, so the apology here, it needs to be as loud as the disrespect. So for this one, I'm going to need everyone to locate their nearest megaphone or order one online. Express delivery, ideally, and apologise to Everton's player of the season so far. Wobes has been a joy to watch in the middle of the park this season. His application skill and final product has reached levels I never thought it could. And it's a pleasure to watch. And I am delighted for him because I think, and I was listening to a podcast recently, Michael Cox, a tactical dude at The Athletic. He was talking about how he actually called this about 3 years ago. And well done to him because in terms of being competent, press-proof and keeping the ball, he's always great from that point of view. It was just that kind of output of a winger. He wasn't really a winger. Now in this new role, he's absolutely flourishing. Seems like a decent bloke as well. So I'm delighted for him. Fulham, obvious one here. Alexander Mitrovic, his goals should be shutting up a lot of people because how many times have we heard people say Mitrovic isn't good enough for the Premier League? Despite him literally being an unhinged monster in the Championship last season. Well, so far this season, the Serb has 7 goals from his opening 9 matches and is silencing a lot of critics. Don't disrespect Championship strikers, all right? It can come back to haunt you. Leeds United, Rodrigo. Yeah, he's enjoyed a goal-scoring start to the season, as we all know. Look, I've seen Rodrigo's 30 million price tag be used against him quite a few times. I think I've probably done it myself, if I'm honest, suggesting that he isn't worth what Leeds have paid for. Yet, he is having a really, really strong season. The Spaniard has 5 goal contributions this season from only 8 matches and has been a fox in the box for this new-look Leeds side under Jesse Marsh. And he was integral to that strong start of the season for Leeds United with Patrick Bamford out on the side. Leicester City, James Maddison, he deserves more credit. There was once a time that James Maddison wasn't really one of the first names on the team sheet for Leicester City. I mean, that is long, long gone. But after a brilliant debut season for the Foxes when he first arrived, he somewhat faded away and people started to sort of make Jack Grealish comparisons. In fact, people thought that he was the better player than Jack Grealish then. Of course, Jack Grealish's star has risen pretty quickly. I've got to be honest, I was always a Jack Grealish guy. And people were trying to make all those comparisons, but they're very, very different players. And he's also been criticised for, you know, the flashy clothes, the lifestyle, the way he sort of comes across sometimes. But the bottom line with Maddison is, in my opinion, he needs to be on the plane to Qatar. He offers output. He offers clutch moments. His technical ability is amazing, and he's stepped up and developed and matured in a big way as a player. So apologise if you were one of those people who didn't rate him. This is a great one. Liverpool, Roberto Firmino. He was written off, but is now... he's currently Liverpool's best player, because with the arrival of Nunes and Jota also being in excellent form last season, I think a lot of people forgot about the presence of Firmino and weren't really bothered if he stayed or if he left in the summer. I bet they're glad now that he has stayed, because the Brazilian has gotten Liverpool out quite a few predicaments this season and has looked dangerous, the most dangerous player in the whole squad so far this season. Manchester City, Erling Haaland, I mean... it has to be. Look, we've all seen the clip of poor Rory, who on this channel has apologised for getting it wrong about Haaland, although he hasn't officially got it wrong at the time of recording. By the time it goes out, probably has, because he said he wouldn't hit the ground running, that he would only get 15 Premier League goals this season, and that would be a very good season for Haaland. And it wouldn't have been a complete disaster. However, Erling Haaland currently sits on 15 goals from his opening 10 matches. So I think most people might disagree with the idea that he will struggle this year. So Rory has apologised, so let's leave it there, okay? Manchester United, obviously, it has to be Lisandro Martinez. He's too short my arse. I mean, again, I'm a hypocrite. Football makes hypocrites of us all, which is why we love the game, right? But I have been made to eat my words, because I now don't really subscribe to the narrative that Lisandro Martinez is too short for the Premier League. Before even a ball was kicked, he was written off, with many saying, of course, that the Premier League is too physical for him. He's been sound so far, and his performances have been just fine, in my opinion. He's also one of the most technically gifted defenders that I think we've ever seen in the Premier League, and that takes him up quite a few levels in my book. Add to that the tenacity that he shows in every single game, and you've got yourself a shrewd signing. I can't say shrewd signing. Shrewd signing! Newcastle United, another obvious one here. Everyone apologise one last time to the boy, Joe Linton. It's the obvious one, right? There's a lot of players that have turned their Newcastle careers around under Eddie Howe's leadership. However, none quite like Joe Linton. The Brazilian midfield destroyer, as we call him now, is such a useful asset in Newcastle's midfield, and they are finally seeing a return on their investment. Not in the way that they expected, of course, but he's almost certainly living up to the price tag. Nottingham Forest, Dean Henderson. Man United let him down. Now he is a bit chirpy, and he has come out and been quite bold and brash in that interview, of course, explaining the problems, which is slightly odd when you're on loan from Manchester United, and with the amount of changes in management, maybe you should have been a bit more careful. But he'd made the move, and people will be looking for him to make several mistakes, and now being given the chance, he is proving that he has quite a lot of quality and is that great goalkeeper that they signed. He's been very good for Forest so far this season, demonstrating his value as a Premier League goalkeeper and silencing a few critics. Southampton. Now, it was tricky to pick one for Southampton, because I don't think anyone's totally exceeded themselves. But I think what I wanted to do was kind of make it about an apology to Southampton in terms of their recruitment, because it is hard to find a player that's been totally disrespected. And you know, Southampton fans, I'm sure you'll let me know in the comments down below. But what I wanted to go for instead was their recruitment, because their recruitment over the summer was questioned due to the lack of experience that they have in the Premier League. It's a very clear profile of player that they were looking for. However, Armel Bella Kotchap has recently been called up and made his debut for the German national team, whilst Romeo Lavia is tearing it up as well. And I think their recruitment team is owed some kudos. In fact, not just kudos, an apology for us doubting them. Well done to you guys. And very soon, when it comes to Southampton, if all goes well, we'll be looking at them as an example after they've put their head above the parapet and gone for these kind of players. Tottenham, Pierre-Emile Højbjerg. Can't believe people wanted Skip to start over him. Maybe that will change again. I know people scream at me, he's been injured, but still, he's been arguably Spurs' best player, Pierre-Emile Højbjerg, and you've got to find a place for him in this team. And there was a time where people were stating that Bentancur and Skip would have been their preferred midfield double pivot. I can't get over the disrespect, and you all need to apologise immediately. I'm not saying Skip's not good, I'm just saying you need to apologise, okay? He's so well-rounded in this double pivot. Even saw it with a goal recently, where he had that moment to get forward, that little bit more, even in a midfield three. He's a very complete midfielder who shows metal but quality as well. West Ham, of course, Craig Dawson, Mr. Reliable. Now, I know, guys, look, I'm not going to apologise for saying he shouldn't be in the England squad because I kind of still stand by that. But the bottom line is this guy has become a cult hero. And when Craig Dawson signed from Watford, I don't think many were excited or particularly enthused about his arrival. However, he's now a cult hero, having been one of the best defenders over the past couple of seasons. And he also cost around 2 million. Let's respect him. Wolves, Nelson Semedo. I have hammered this guy in the past and he hasn't been that bad this season. I'll be honest, there's no one that really jumps out at Wolves as the obvious choice. However, Semedo has had his criticism at times during his Wolves career, but he has been decent this season. He's an attacking right back or wing back, and I think had the shackles on a bit under Large, and I think Semedo is one that we might owe an apology further down the line if Wolves begin playing attacking football. One to keep an eye on, I'd say. So there you have it, guys. Which ones did I miss out? Who would you like to apologise to? Let me know in the comments down below. Hit the subscribe button if you enjoyed this one, and make sure you hit the notification bell as well. And I'll see you next time. Is it too lonely to see you?